What should someone with familial hypercholesterolemia eat if they also have prediabetes?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
This actually is really similar to an earlier question, except that it's not about my patient, it's about me.
Okay.
So I do have FH, familial, I can't ever say the long thing, so familial hypercholesterolemia. And I also have multiple food sensitivities. So my diet is already pretty limited. I can't eat wheats or glutens, and I can't eat any dairy. And corn is not great. So there are a lot of different limitations that I already have. I'm trying to do everything that I can to address my vascular inflammation. My cholesterol is obviously pretty high. You and I talked about this some time ago. I am seeing a cardiologist who has me on statins. I'm already experiencing exercise intolerance, where when I go out and play a game, I'm wiped out for that night and the following day, like I got run over by a truck. And that's at a very low dose. So I'm trying to figure out all the things that I can do on my own to try and address this. And specifically, I think I need to get after the inflammation, because I have always struggled with inflammation and I have a couple of autoimmunes. So the question really is saying that saturated fats will raise my vascular inflammation. And from what you were saying, saturated fats, cholesterol, will get into my bloodstream and not get cleared, which I guess is maybe the same thing. I'm trying to figure out where to go with my diet when now fats are an issue as well, and I'm trying to address autoimmune and keep my glucose level low too, because I'm just borderline pre-diabetic.
Okay, so I think there's a number of separable issues here. So I guess the first one would be you believe that you are experiencing exercise intolerance from the statins that you're on. And so it might be possible to try to brainstorm things around that, but it would be ideal if you could manage your blood lipids with your diet sufficiently to at least reduce the dose of the statin. If that's causing the exercise intolerance through mechanisms that we're not quite sure about. And so I do think that doing what we talked about before around the lines of a low fat, low saturated fat, low cholesterol diet is going to be the best way to do that. Now, you mentioned being pre-diabetic, and so it is important to take the low fat part of that, which implies a low fat, high carbohydrate diet,
exactly, in
sort of like the full manifestation. So that is first of all, it's a separable component of the diet. So you can eat a low saturated fat, low cholesterol diet without necessarily eating a low fat diet. And then second of all, as I talked about before, the effect of that on blood lipids is dependent on your insulin, the healthfulness of your insulin pathway.
Right.
And
right.
So, you know, over time, that's something where you can kind of play the balance between those two things. And as you improve your blood glucose handling, you can fit in more carbohydrates to have a fuller dietary effect. And so I think that, you know, in the more immediate situation, I don't think there's any problem with going on a low cholesterol, low saturated fat diet and emphasizing, I don't think you mentioned any protein foods that you can't tolerate, but emphasizing lean proteins, and whole food lean proteins are things like white fish and white fish, low fat dairy and poultry products. Most poultry products, like chicken breast. I'm really not a fan in the big scheme of things of like boneless, skinless chicken breast. But if for someone who's specifically trying to get lean proteins in, chicken breast is great. And if it comes down to being able to lower the dose of a drug that appears to be causing exercise intolerance, then I think that's, you know, it does make sense to go down that direction. And so just emphasizing, you know, and of course there are also, you know, other things like, whey protein or something where if you're trying to, get something more convenient in as a way of getting lean protein, and that can also be an option.
Yeah. I do use pea protein. I can't use anything dairy, but pea protein.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. So, you know, nix the whey protein and low fat dairy concept, but otherwise right. intact. And so that's the, you know, and then the high cholesterol foods, you know, saturated fats, kind of obvious. That can be plant oils such as coconut oil, but it can also be, you know, dairy fat is especially high. Ruminant meat fat is fairly high. And then, you know, most traditional oils aren't super low. So there is saturated fat in olive oil and salmon. And so those are things that are not, you know, aren't, you wouldn't want to consume them in excess or in an unlimited fashion, but, you know, having those fattier foods can be used in moderation, mainly under the circumstances of being pre-diabetic and wanting to manage blood glucose. So then the second component of that would be managing blood glucose. And I don't think it's a good idea to condemn all carbohydrates as a means of managing that. I think the best thing would be to get a continuous glucose monitor or a regular glucose monitor. If you're using a regular glucose monitor, use 30-minute, 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour time intervals after a meal, and collect a baseline before a meal, and look at how do different starches that you don't have an immunological response to, so you don't have to test grains because you know you don't tolerate them. But other foods that are rich in starches, whether it's carrots or potatoes or sweet potatoes or whatever it is, whatever's in your list of tolerated foods, how do those different foods affect your blood sugar differently when you control for the carbohydrate intake? And then also, you know, what is the carbohydrate intake that you can tolerate in the context of a standard mixed meal with the lean proteins you are normally consuming that a lot that doesn't cause your blood sugar to go over 140 at any of those time points. And so with a little bit of experimentation, you can find out, you can sort of like develop starch blocks, you know, like 30 grams of carrot equals, you know, 45 grams of carbohydrate from potatoes equals whatever, you know, all defined as the maximum amount of starch from the whole food that you can tolerate without your blood sugar going above 140 at any time point. And then, you know, you can develop a system where you can substitute those blocks of carbohydrate, knowing that they fit within what you've tested. And you can periodically retest just randomly to make sure that it's still working. But you've gotten a data-driven, individualized plan of amounts of specific types of carbohydrates that you tolerate from both a blood sugar and an immunological standpoint. And then you have your means of balancing the protein and the fat in a way that is moderated. And then as you get your blood sugar more under control, you can eventually increase the carbohydrate and decrease the fat. And those things together should help you manage your blood lipids in a way that might help you lower the dose of the medication, which you'd have to work with your doctor on, the prescribing doctor. So if you can do that, that might help the exercise intolerance. And the second, so that's one sort of super component of what you asked about. Second super component of what you asked about would be, can you get around the statin effect on the exercise intolerance? And so I'm of mixed mind on what might be causing that. I do think that it's possible that that inhibited MK4 and CoQ10 synthesis could both be at work there. Both of them are important in the mitochondria for energy metabolism. Vitamin K2 goes beyond that by playing a role in the mobilization of fuel from adipose and liver to muscles during exercise through an effect on osteocalcin and interleukin 6 signaling. Something I believe I covered it in the Ultimate Vitamin K2 resource at chrismasterjohnphd.com/K2. But anyway, there are, you know, there's multiple ways that MK4 and CoQ10, both of which are decreased in synthesis by statins, that they would play into exercise intolerance. So that's one component. Another component of that would be that I think just generally feeding lipid-soluble things to the muscles is going to be an issue. And so if you are increasing LDL receptor activity or you're biasing lipids towards the liver and away from the muscles. And so the only way I can think of to get around that is really to just ramp up the supply of fat-soluble nutrients. And so you might, and that's going to be especially important if you're eating a lower fat diet, because your absorption of fat soluble nutrients in general is going to be lower. But supplementing with a mixed cocktail of fat soluble vitamins might be a way to get around that. I'm speculating, but it seems like it's probably important. So that's I guess how I would see that second super component of what you said. And then I believe the third big super component was addressing vascular inflammation. I'm not sure what you are thinking of there. What measurements have you gotten of vascular inflammation?
You know, honestly, I've got just the most basic stuff. I think in general, they're not seeing really high markers. They're just telling me that saturated fats will increase vascular. I have high oxidized LDL. That's one of the markers.
Got it. So everything that I talked about in the first super component getting the blood lipids under control will directly impact the vascular inflammation. Your case,
okay.
LDL oxidation probably is the main thing contributing to that.
Okay. All right. That's very helpful. Thanks a lot. Especially about the exercise intolerance. I had sort of dropped off some of my supplements, and I can ramp those back up and see what happens.
Yeah.
Because I'm on a minimum statin. It's 10 milligrams 3 times a week. So if I can't handle it here, I can't handle it.
Sounds great.
Thanks a lot.
All right. You're welcome. Take care.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. From now through February or March, whatever it takes to get it done, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for my consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.